Isn't it nice when things just work?
It said that it took 600 takes to get this ad going. It cost a few million dollars. But just what I found, they have used every part that is there in a Honda card and they set it up in a manner, and at the end looks beautiful. And many times the reality is we do admire excellence and effectiveness. But you know what? The Lord Jesus promised this wonderful blessing over us. And John 14:12 says, "Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works that I have been doing. And they will do even greater than these, because I am going to the Father." Now, every time I pick this up and I went sharing on what I'm going to share today for some time, but every time I hear this, I said, "Lord," okay, every time I said, "Lord, I will no way come anyway close to what you did when you were here on earth." And whenever we discussed it, when we do training and we talked about what did Jesus do, and the simplest thing is he walked, he spoke, and there was healing. And then he promises in the scripture that the things that I do, you will do, and greater than these you will do. That's a wonderful promise to start with. So it's not just the Honda ad or somewhere where we are looking at excellence and effectiveness. This is a season that examinations are on. And as Rohit came and shared, my youngest one starts exam tomorrow. We have a number of children, and it's a joy for us as cells, as church, to pray for these children. And all of us desire excellence. So I just feel, maybe take every parent, will you take that? If you have a child who's heading for an examination, give them the promise of God's excellence into their lives. Okay, having said that, today is probably less of a sermon, and maybe it will be more of something of encouragement. And I believe that there is a takeaway for each and every one of us here with a degree of excellence that God has promised to us. Now, so I've titled this as Envision Effectiveness for One, by Anyone, and Everyone. Okay? Shall we look to the Lord in prayer? Lord, we are so delighted that not only you have loved us, you have blessed us and redeemed us, but in your word, Lord, through your word, you have declared a promise, a blessing, a prophecy over us that is so edifying, so encouraging, Lord. So we look to you this morning, Lord. Each one of us, we believe your word, which says we will excel in what we do like you did. And because you are with the Father and you have sent the Holy Spirit to be with us, we will do great things for you, Lord. This we ask, that our hearts be prepared to hear and be effective. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. If you see the clip, or rather the pictures that are in front of you, I am not going to talk to you about the architecture or the mythology of the pyramids, or this structure which is somewhere in South America. So I had to find hard to get a pyramid shaped structure, and this is in Dubai, a mall. So why am I taking the pyramid as a structure? Architecturally, though we don't see many buildings, unlike after the pyramids of Giza they were made, it is the most stable structure that is possible, because there is a big and strong base, and it becomes narrower as you get up. It's like when you pile up naturally sand, it piles up. So I believe that if you want stability and effectiveness in what we do, here are some of the things that is very essential. And what is this pyramid of stability? we must ensure that we know a foundation which is broad, stable, and well established. And that is why Sunday after Sunday we emphasize so much. That is why we work so much on the foundation, and we have a bunch of almost 20 plus people who are going through the foundations right now. And that's so important and essential. Only when the foundation is established, we are expecting that we will have values that will build on these foundations, that will enable us to last through the storms and weathers of life. And what will be left when we face the storms is that which is built, as the scripture says, with gold, silver, and precious stones. And coming smaller than this is to establish the principles that last. You know, we are very good at copying models that work somewhere. Whenever we want to do something, we say, who else has done it? And we try and take a model. One of the errors that happens is we take the model and we just exactly reproduce. And that's a recipe for success, for disaster. But the recipe for success, and one of my resource persons I learned a lot about sales is a person called Joel Komisky. And he says this, models may fail, but principles that are established on foundations and with true biblical values will never fail. And today I intend to share actually just these three. But just to complete the structure, only after we have these do we establish what are the priorities. That is, when we come to a crossroad, what is it that we choose? And now see the interesting part. Then come the practices, how we do it. And what's on top? The smallest, the programs. But in event management, everybody just sees the program. And all the effort goes lopsided into making that effective. So I just thought I'll convey that. I want to tell you a story that I first read when we were doing many years back in our first, then we used to just call it as house church. And I read the story in a series called God's Family, and I would like to read it to you. It's a story of curved brick. And it goes like this. The first workman who saw curved brick laughed out aloud and threw him aside. This curved brick is useless. Curved brick began to have doubts about himself. Maybe I am not a brick at all. I could be a paperweight or a bookend. But deep inside he knew he wanted and he was a part of the building. Now some of the other bricks were discussing whether curved brick would ever fit in with them when Mr. Architect visited the building site. And the workman asked him to come and explain one part of the building which though they had the blueprint, they just could not go ahead and progress. When the architect saw their dilemma, he asked, where is curved brick? Sheepishly, one worker pointed to the trash heap. No one offered any excuse when they saw the scowl on the architect's face. Curved brick could not believe it. Architect himself came to the pile to pull him from the debris, dust it off, set him in place in the building. And he says, I personally designed somewhere, and I know this is not exact representation. I personally designed this brick to fit here. Curved brick felt so good to be where he belonged. There are many times we could perhaps feel, I do not conform to the way I see everyone is. And maybe there may be someone who's walked in this morning and saying, I am different. I am not a regular brick. I am a curved brick. How will I fit? And that is where I want to say this. God has personally designed each one of us. In Ephesians 2:10, it says, Paul in the book of Ephesians establishes wonderful truths of the new way of living that we have. And in Ephesians 2:10, he says, we are his workmanship. He has worked on each one of us. You know, from Psalms 139, which talks much more on that. created in Christ Jesus for good works which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. And a little later in that same chapter, he says, and there the purpose comes, consequently you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens built with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone, in him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord, and in him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in whom God dwells, or God lives by his Spirit. And that's, and I will just very soon string all this together. And from there, so I shared with you right in the beginning about curve brick. I've given you some scriptures. Let me quickly run through and bring you this story. This is a very interesting story. Jesus loved this family called Lazarus and Mary and Martha. And there was once, like, Jesus would go, you know, one of the things we get this picture at times of God is like a principal or a headmaster, always waiting, you know, with a little cane and waiting for us to go wrong and just give him one knock on our head. But if you look at the earthly ministry of Jesus, there is this one characteristic that defined him. Jesus had fun. Whenever he spent time with people, one of the accusations they brought against Jesus is, you have too much of fun. He said, other people are serious, but you seem to have fun. Okay, so there were times he just went. He went into homes, and the Bible doesn't talk too much, but there are some glimpses. So this is one story. And in this story, Jesus is coming. Now, yesterday evening, I had guests home, and my wife Vinita is not there. But I said, instead of a family, was visiting all the way from Himachal. And I said, okay, I've got a maid, so we'll cook something. And I know how tense it was. So after everything went very well, the food was fine. But the evening I told my wife, I said, I don't think I'm going to be doing this. I can't do this often because there's a lot to be planned. So there was something of that kind of situation about Martha and Mary. So it says, as Jesus and his disciples were on the way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened a home to him. She had a sister called Mary, who was a very, very holy sister as per Martha. So she sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and said, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. And the salad is still to be cut. Yesterday I forgot to serve the salad. Okay. So Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed. Indeed, only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away. So before you go away with the conclusion, this is useless Martha and only Mary is good, let me highlight something. Now if you look at both Martha and Mary, this is what Martha was trying to do. She was performing a service, nothing wrong. She was making something happen. Someone's got to make it happen. Preparing for Jesus coming. Isn't it good? You have to prepare for Jesus coming. Running things smoothly. Coordinating his schedule. Jesus, when you come, first you will sit down here, then you will do this. We have program sheets. We excel at that. Okay. Getting busy for him and fulfilling her duty. Now, any problems here? If there was no Martha, we'd definitely not get a lot of stuff done. But the idea of this passage is, what is Mary doing? And Mary entered into the presence where Jesus was. She sat at his feet. She looked up to Jesus. She was listening to what Jesus was saying. She was receiving his power. She was feeling his touch. She was resting in his love and freedom, and she was doing his will. And Jesus said, Mary chose what was better. So yes, we need Martha, and praise God for Martha's, But in the larger context between the two, there is this affirmation. And as I said, I will string this back. Let me share one thing which I just want to flash. What did Jesus tell us finally when he was leaving? And we all know this is the Great Commission. He says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. And he says, in this entire commission, he is talking of discipleship, and he is giving us the assurance of what he is there. So, as I said, foundations are big. What I have tried to do is I have tried to establish in anything and everything we do. Of course, this morning our focus is on sales. But I suggest to you that are we willing to become his workmanship? Are we willing to become people in whom God dwells? Are we willing to not just by ourselves, but that promise of when two or three are there, we gather together and say, Lord, where we are, like your scripture has promised, you will dwell in their midst. Are we willing to choose the better part? We can never get it all done. It's never possible. I belong to the military, and I know there are times none of my senior officers ever wanted to hear something can't be done. They want this to be done and this to be done and this to be done. Sometimes we do it, we try, but the wisdom comes in choosing at that moment what is the better part, and never forget the Great Commission. So I'm offering to you what I believe the foundation is: being Christ's workmanship through his presence, his power, and his purpose. Being Christ's workmanship through his presence, through his power, and his purpose. Can I ask you to just soak that in? Because if we do nothing else, whether we meet on Sunday, whether we have time of worship, whether we have times of intercession, whether we meet as cells, whether we reach out, whether we are having tea together, if this is what is our emphasis every time and any time, then there is one assured that foundational base on which the building is being built will never be shaken. So I always believe this is the basic filter, the basic essence of taking things forward. Now, the encouragement is always in Jesus. Jesus lived this. Jesus left it as a foundational key. And in one word, all he is asking us, will we choose to rest in him? And you know, in this current era, when everything is instant, when the responses are instant, when the demands are instant, when the attention is there, and no one is willing to have no for an answer, Jesus gives the answer to rest. And you know how Jesus did it? I love the scripture. I love this way Jesus said. Jesus, who is all powerful, says, truly I tell you, truly, truly I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. The Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, and he will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. And that is, for me, to be at rest in Jesus Christ, just as he was at rest in the Father. And that is, from the title if you remember, effectiveness is not for us to excel and to receive the accolades. Our effectiveness is for Jesus. He is the author. He is the purpose. He is the destination. That is why it is being his presence, his power, and his purpose. And if we have soaked that in, if we have established it, then let me say this kind of life cannot be lived just on Sunday morning or on Sunday afternoon or an evening. This kind of life cannot be effective unless it becomes a lifestyle unto us. And one of the hearts of having cell groups or house groups or small groups is that we can take this reality that can come at a time of celebration. And somewhere in the mid 60s it was articulated in this fashion. It is not of this last century. It's a model, it's a strategy of the very first century. But it was put in the form that we have it. One of the early resource persons was Ralph Naber, and there have been many great people, Yonggi Cho, there has been Lawrence Kong, Larry Stockstill, the Bethany World Prayer Movement, and as I said, my favorite, one of my favorite resource people is Joel Comiskey, and they put this whole idea or a strategy of cells. And let me, I think it's time to just define. So I am offering something. The word cell can be used in many ways, but this is a definition of the cell I want to offer to you. And it says cell is a group of 4 to 15. Now I can spend a lot of time explaining the mathematics behind it, but we just leave it at that stage. 4 to 15 that meets weekly outside the church building for the purpose of evangelism, community and discipleship with the goal of multiplication. Some people are gifted to do this, and I found that is why I admire this man called Joel Comiskey, because he was doing his PhD in Fuller College, Fuller Seminary, and he did his PhD in cells, and he's worked a lot. I enjoy here seeing his blog, and this is a definition he articulated. Now I'm going to flash a small graphic I made out of that. Now these are the basic elements when we say cell. It is small in size. Now, Vinamji opened the time for, if we have heard something from God, come and share. Now, I'll flash a scripture very soon. How many can share? At best 3 or 4, and after that we somehow, I know there are times people are itching and you sometimes want to say, why is the pastor curbing me? No, because obviously when we have a gathering this big. So small is makes participation. So it is small in size. It is meeting regularly. Weekly, like we look forward to Sunday, we meet, and the aim is not here the building, but we penetrate into the world. That's why outside the church building, and quite often when we meet as cells, and that is why this order is important, we forget that there is a great commission on us. It's not about me, it's about penetrating the world and building community, serving the community. And what are the tools that we have? The tools are discipleship and multiplication. As I said, foundation, and after foundation comes values. So if I start on values, I'll take 2 hours. And I don't intend doing that. I'm just going to flash, they're already there in your notes, 3 scriptures. These 3 scriptures give you a snapshot idea of what the value system is meant to be as we meet in ourselves. Now, Galatians, the scripture says, let us not become weary in doing good, for we will reap a harvest if we don't give up. And that's why we have to persist. It's very hard to persist alone. Recently, we have a group of people who are marathoners. So I have also declared my intent in a couple of years I will run. And immediately one of these avid marathoners, why couple of years, next year? I just kept quiet. Okay, but there is an encouragement. We can do it. So when you meet regularly, so when we have, be good, do good to people. This is a scripture I was saying. Paul says this to the Ephesians, speak to one another, or actually here it is there. What shall we say? When you come together, each of you as a hymn, a word of instruction, revelation, a tongue, and an interpretation. And I would love to see that happen on Sunday morning when all of you together, each one of you share an interpretation, and we will go in the evening. So sometimes, you know, we are itching, we have a powerful testimony. Don't have ill feelings towards a pastor when he tells you today, can you leave it? But there's a great opportunity. When we come together in our cells, we can share our testimonies. 15 people sharing testimony, even if we have those longish testimonies, no, where we have to give every excruciating detail, it is okay if we do it in the cells. And one of the things is that then a couple of them shared here, or a few word which comes here. So it is definitely, Paul is not talking about the Sunday service here. They met in the temple and in homes. This scripture, most of the encouragement as a church in the New Testament is all about the midweek. And I read this verse, I said, no, that doesn't make sense. I actually looked at any place where there was an exhortation or doing something together. It made more sense when I looked at it as a small group of about 12 or 10 people meeting in homes. It suddenly made much more sense. Here, I can say anything. Of course, I can't say anything. But I can say, and I'm not expecting this one. Somebody agrees, disagrees, we leave it. But in a sense, we can disagree. Yeah, I know cell leaders start pulling their hair out when some of those things. There are some people who are experts as just taking off on a tangent. Okay, but that's okay. That happens once in a while. It just triggers things. And that's where the skill comes in, working together to people and taking them. There is such a beautiful encouragement. As I said, in our cell at NOFRA, we have a great mission and we've extended it. We are right now praying for children. Why? We have 5 children in the cell who are appearing at board exam. It's a need. And from that need that arises, when we do this, we can reach out to people. So there is a great joy. So what am I talking of? Sorry for the color. But these are the 5 values. Everyone functions. Now notice, everyone. I'll keep using the word. Everyone is in a process of growth. I'll give you one example. Everyone is involved in serving. Everyone is reaching and touching the community. Everyone is taking the message of Christ unto the people. I remember, I intend telling two stories. Many years back, we used to meet. I remember when I first came to Colaba, and then very soon we established 3 or 4 house groups. We didn't call it cells that time. And I remember this wonderful person. These stories, I'm not going to take names. You can choose to guess. I don't want to embarrass some people, but there came this person who spent 2 hours without opening his mouth. And that can be challenging. Especially there are some people who are very extroverted. They want, you ask a question and you just sit. I'll let you guess. He continued being part of the house group. 6 months later, he was most popular when he came up on stage, and he would start speaking and people would roll in laughter. He started sharing little by little, taking part. He went on, and of course, is back in Bombay. I remember a family. We were in Cochin, and they came. They were moving from Delhi to Cochin, and they just came and says, we were part of the Lutheran church, and then there they were part of some church. And so we just somehow, we want to see a different place, because they had started attending in Delhi, the Delhi Bible Fellowship, and they liked that entire pattern of being participative. So they said, straight away, I welcome them. I said, why don't you come and meet us midweek? And by the way, we are doing something, some biblical foundation. So they're very excited about biblical foundations, and they started attending. And that time the elder daughter was just looking for admission into engineering. Today is a person, of course, in the military. Some of you know, again, I'm not taking the name. Both the children are married. Both children are active in ministry. And this person is an elder in the church in Cochin. I can tell you story after story of people who just stepped in and walked in, where they started to function, they found growth in their lives. They would talk and work about it. And like this particular family was always present when we had we did an Easter service, and they had never acted in their lives. They took part in the skit, and they've become, he is an excellent MC now, and as I said, they are touching lives like anything. So these are the values that we look forward. Now the most important, having established the values, having established the foundations and laid the values, I want to move to what I want to leave as my primary emphasis today. And I want to come back to that scripture with where I started. And this is my encouragement for us to take it home with us. And I want to say this. Can I do this? Can I ask us all to read this together at the count of three? One, two, three. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to the Father. Amen? Amen. Okay, what is the primary principle that cells have become what is understood in the last and this century as an excellent strategy? In fact, it's not about things. There are two principles that are involved. Cells enable everyone to function. Now, you would have seen, those who have been coming here regularly, every Sunday you see a wonderful arrangement. Somehow magically all the wires go into place, the DLP, you don't know the tension that happens 10 minutes before, okay, but somehow the DLP will get set, things will there, water will come, sometimes the water gets changed also, okay, no, it's fresh water every time someone does, some people there, notes come magically, they come onto all the chairs, you know, a lot of things happen. It's not possible with a few people. And here is, on behalf of the pastors, I can announce this. The church is hiring, lot of vacancies available. I'm serious. We have place for many of you. I didn't talk about salary, okay? Come and serve. You have a gifting. Each one of us has a gifting. By the way, did I talk about Sunday morning? Okay, I was giving examples. I am talking of cells. Every one of us has a role. Everyone. If you are not a part of cell, okay, today I'm not doing announcement, but this sounds similar. Okay, if you are not a part of cell, can I encourage you to be part of one? We need you. There is something that cannot be done unless you are a part. And the second part is leadership. Now I'm going to say something which some people have found it very challenging, and they find it very hard to believe. In fact, I've had pastors who have argued vehemently with me. I have not yielded, and I don't intend to yield today also. Okay, what is cell? Cell is a strategy which I believe is the New Testament pattern for leadership development and effectiveness of vision. I don't know if you heard this before, but it is two functions, two purposes. Everyone functions, everyone grows. Because it is the New Testament pattern. If you read Acts 2, especially from verse 42 onwards, they say, and they met in temple courts and in homes. Who handled all the things? There were 3,000 men. And whenever the Bible, for some reason, uses men as a unit of number, so there were women and children. So large number. Who administered it? There were just 12 disciples. You count the 120 who were gathered. Fine, 120. Managing 3,000 plus. And a few days later, 4,000. It's only possible because there were many who stepped forward and say, I will take the lead. And that didn't happen overnight. Some of these people who were the 12 disciples, but there were many homes that were opened up. So this I believe is at the very heart of it. When long back I used to handle the Sunday school, and that's why that still I always say, If you have not taken a class in Sunday school, there's something of training which is still pending. So I think Perval will be very happy, and all the team who are part, please volunteer to be part of the Sunday school. At least come and take a class. Why I'm saying, I remember one of the time we realized our cell was mostly the people who were the teachers and volunteers at the Sunday school cell. Here are some of the fruits of that. Okay? Kolaba Sunday School organized the first children's camp, Sunday school camp, and one of the participants is going to become a mother in 2 days, 2-3 days. There were people here, we did stuff, and there are they have work of each of these people. All the members of that cell are either leading a church or leading a group of churches or ministering somewhere. Actually, I recently took stock, except for one person who's I couldn't locate. Every one of them is in a place of leadership. It's an amazing tool. When we start handling one responsibility, you know, sometimes we feel that game we are playing, why should I play that game? Let me tell you on that, it was not planned. There was one particular day in our cell, we said, today can you share about the wonderful time you spent with your father? We never progressed beyond that line that day, because one person just broke down. That person had a problem with their father, and that entire thing turned around. It was just a simple sharing, and people started ministering. I saw healing take place. People were just weeping, and the person who broke down called their father, and they patched up and made up. You'll be surprised at how God just transforms things. So here is some of the principles. I'm going to share 4 principles that make effectiveness possible, especially in context, and all of us can do it. So let me say here, now this is not to embarrass you. You are here either as a member of a cell or as a leader of a cell. How many over here are currently, don't feel bad, I'll come to something very interesting in a minute, are not having the opportunity to attend a single midweek gathering other than Sunday in the entire week? Can I see your hands? Okay. If I add the people who may be feeling shy, you can put your hand down. It's about half the church, which is okay. But here is a promise. Long back, someone from the church encouraged me. When I see someone walking through that door into the church building or to the home where the cell meets, I do not see someone whom I can share the gospel and make tomorrow follow Christ. I see a person who can not just lead a cell but oversee a group of 20 to 100 cells. As we see, so will it happen. And let me share from a place called Bogota. They have one place, they started with 8 people in a family dining hall. Today they have 40,000 cells. The janitor, the one who looks after the cleaning and the housekeeping, oversees 250 cells. Now, we don't have to get challenged, I just gave you options. We'll be very happy if we grow from 20 to 50 cells. So, we don't have to have some super human targets. But let me share the principles. Jesus said, come follow me and I will send you out to fish for people. So, every one of us is a, read that, potential. Okay, cell is there, but even if you drop the word cell, is a potential leader. Every one of me, everyone, every single person. Now, this is a selfie generation. For the elder people, please forgive me. But we are very comfortable taking selfies. So if you are taking selfies, just pat yourself on your chest. Just do this for a minute. Okay, just do that if you don't mind. And say, I am going to be a good leader. Come on, say that. That's biblical. I'm going to be a good leader, a good cell leader. Catch that. That's Jesus' heart for us. We are not here. In fact, I tell this, and some cell leaders get very offended, but please forgive me. I always say, I pray that you will not continue to meet together forever here. You say, what's wrong with you? But that you will, each of you will plant a cell that after a while you will be meeting somewhere else. And then you stay connected. So, second, Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. Why do we come to the Lord? Every believer must be equipped and trained to lead a cell. To all the cell leaders, can I urge you? You are already a cell leader, your job is done. And cell leader has this wonderful purpose which I like to call stepney. You know what a stepney is used for? When something goes flat, you put the stepney. Cell leader primarily pitches in when someone doesn't turn up. Now if that day nobody turns up, you sit there and do all four W's with one more person who sat with you. In the RG, I'm going to take this example. I have four children, four girls who sit here and do wonderful stuff. I love to see them together. And I told, you are already a cell. You have qualified for the minimum number to form a cell. Can you find, so here is my encouragement, church. Do you find two couples or four singles or in any combination, you can get a chance to meet midweek? You are ready to launch a cell. And there is a purpose. We'd love to facilitate you. We'd love to equip you. And very soon if you do it, you'll grow. The moment you start growing, start training others. Start training each one. It's quite simple. Okay, just to, why I use the graphic, this I don't have to explain. Among geese, when they fly, when the leader tires, it moves back and somebody else moves into the place. So all can do it. Then, why are we trained? And one of the things in BBC, we will train you to death. Sorry, I have people have said, what more training? How much more training we need? But no, we need to train. But there is a reason. Why do we train? Why are we training? Because the purpose of a lamp is not to be, it's a good lamp. Now close it like bone china, put it inside the cupboard. The purpose of a lamp is to burn. And here is the purpose. Every trained leader is a start of a new opportunity. In the kingdom of God, there are no wasted talents. If you see someone, if they've gone through a process, don't waste it. Fourth principle, this is that famous fish and bread breakfast of Jesus. Okay, at the end of that wonderful baked, stone-baked fish, Jesus has this encounter with Peter. Now Peter was the most brilliantly trained and perfect person for anything possible. He had a habit of putting his foot exactly where it had not to be put. But no, Jesus had equipped him to do wonderful things. At the end, Jesus says, do you love me? He says, yes, I love you. Feed my lambs. He says, do you love me? Lord, you know that I love you. He said, take care of my sheep. You really become a disciple when you become a leader of other people. This was one of the sentences in the cell training that just shook me. He says, go and make disciples of all nations. And Jesus chose words very wisely. When you make disciples, it's not just about following. And I remember in the discipleship manual, Stanley writes this line, follow the pastor as he follows the master. But in that, as you continue, when you are following, there has to be someone who is following you. And that's how Jesus said, I will grow and I will touch the kingdoms and I will touch the world. Cell leadership. Here is, in case at the end of all my encouragement, if some of you feel you are not qualified. Okay? Cell leadership is not dependent on your personality type. I am a person who is an HR resource person. I have done enough qualifications. I can sit with you and do your profiling, what your personality type, which of the 16, which of the desk, I can do all that. And one thing is there, there is no personality type that is disqualified to be a cell leader. So it's not, if I'm extroverted, introverted, I'm a one who is risk taker or cautious, I'm the one who's people oriented or task oriented, I am qualified to lead a cell. Cell leadership is not based on my gifting, because unlike other kinds of leadership, you actually make people who are part of your cell do most of the things. You are more of a facilitator. Cell leadership is not dependent on gender, praise God. In Yongisto's church, when he wanted to transform the church, the women of the church rose up. And I have seen women's cells are the most successful cells. Place men need to learn a lot. Of course, serving, hospitality, food also tastes better. And cell leadership definitely does not depend on education. When Jackie Pullinger, who used to work among the drug addicts in Hong Kong, she went to meet one of her people she was working with, and that person had got arrested. When the person got arrested, she just stepped into the church and just said, stepped into the jail meeting ground, and all she could talk in 15 minutes, Jesus love you and Jesus will be your friend today. You know, she came back after 2 weeks. This man who had only received that word, he was a drug addict, that Jesus loves you and Jesus will be your friend today, had brought three more people. All they knew is Jesus loves you and he'll be your friend today. No education, no training, no qualification, praise God. This is not Obama support, okay? But yes, I can. I can, and I want us to consider this. Can we make a commitment that we will commit our lives to reach out and gather people into God's kingdom so that we can build them up and send them out, that they will gather and bring people into kingdom, who will then reach out, build them and send them. And the process, that is where Jesus said, and the gospel of Jesus will be preached unto the ends of the earth. It is a geometrical progression, not an arithmetic addition. When we touch lives, it's like a network. And I would like to quote, leave with this example of a farmer. Farmer was given 4 seeds of mango and 4 seeds of strawberry. Actually not seeds, they were saplings. So he had a field. He says the mango tree needs space, so he had a plot of land and he put one sapling on each corner of the field. So the mango tree takes at least 5 to 6 years before fruit. So kept on growing a flower. But along with that, he put 4 strawberry saplings also in between at the border. The mango took 5 years to start fruiting. But at the end of 1 year, the whole field was occupied by the strawberries. You know why? Each strawberry, as it sends the root down, it also sends 4 runners in 4 different directions. And as they go, they plant root. And each one of them again sent 3 or 4 runners out. When Jaya was speaking on cells last month, she said, will we break the elephant mold of growth and will we go into the rabbit mold of multiplication? I'm just asking with you mangoes and strawberries. It doesn't matter whether you understand elephants and rabbits or mangoes and strawberries. Can we commit ourselves that we will commit our lives to reaching out and gathering and building and sending out? Let's pray. Father, we believe that you have promised over us effectiveness that will last that will envision us to see as you saw us, as you have fashioned us, you have designed us, Lord, to be your workmanship, to be the ones whom you are equipping by your very presence, your power and your purpose, Lord. That you will ask us, you will enable us to build on the values of being functional, of growing, of serving, of blessing the community and reaching out to people, Lord. That we will see that we are on a mission, and that's not just about us, but those who are around us, that we are your instruments to be a blessing in their life, that we will build that life, we will invest into them, Lord, so that they will be equipped to reach and expand and extend where we may not be able to, Lord. And I pray like you prayed for us, would you bless the people who are in our contact group, Lord, that because of your presence in our life, they will be blessed, Lord. And I pray, Father, you will bless the ones they reach out to, Lord, that truly your kingdom will grow at a pace that is beyond our imagination, Lord. So we'll all, yes, Lord, we will find effectiveness because it's all about you. It's for one, that is Jesus. And the way you have enabled us, anyone can do and everyone will do, Lord. So we bless you and we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father. And yes, Lord, now I pray, Father, the love of the Father and the grace of Jesus Christ our Savior and the enabling presence and the power of Holy Spirit, transform us, Lord, to be an infecting and an influencing generation, Lord, into this world that so needs you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Truly effectiveness is our inheritance. We bless you and give you all glory in Jesus' name.